My very dear sisters and brothers, happy Indigenous Peoples Day. It really is an honor to be able to celebrate with you on this first anniversary of Seattle's Indigenous Peoples Day. And it was an honor last year to be able to sponsor this resolution. And we have to be clear, this resolution, just as we made clear last year, this Indigenous Peoples Day is a recognition of Indigenous people, but it is also a correction of revisionist history. It is a rejection of Columbus Day. Many generations of young Americans have, unfortunately, in school, learned a fictionalized version of history that idealizes mass murderers like Columbus and ignores the genocide of an entire continent and teaches racism where some people's humanity is deemed less meaningful than others. And this racism and the historical context has, we know, ongoing consequences on poverty and inequality and the actual lives of our Indigenous sisters and brothers today. And by declaring Indigenous Peoples Day, it was a symbolic opportunity for us to begin a real fight back to stop this marginalization and towards equality. This year, I think, we are defining the tradition of what this holiday can mean to us. Either Indigenous Peoples Day can become a day when politicians can pretend that they care one day out of the year with empty rhetoric, or it can be a day of struggle where every year we continue to score new victories for Seattle's Indigenous communities. But that's our choice. We have the power to decide what Indigenous Peoples Day will be going forward. And we know we have a lot still left to fight for. We know we have to fight for systemic, racial, economic, gender, and environmental justice. Let this day be a reminder for us that we still have that systemic struggle ahead of us. And what are we doing today in that to build that tradition? At 2 o'clock at full council, I'm going to be presenting another resolution from you, which will acknowledge the horrors that were perpetrated to the United States boarding schools policy. And organizers here will tell you that nothing of this celebration today was automatic. Organizers had to fight to have a march as part of the celebration today. There has also been talk of another Italian Heritage Month, which we support, but not as a backdoor to bring back Columbus Day. And we had to fight to bring forward the boarding school resolution as part of this program in this room. Through the boarding school resolution, we are saying that genocide not only includes killing people en masse, it also includes attempting to eradicate a people's culture, and that was integral to the boarding school policy. So my dear sisters and brothers, every year on Indigenous Peoples Day, let us use the celebrations to continue our struggle. And let us start discussing today. What do we want to fight for from now until Indigenous Peoples Day 2016? I thank you for all your courage. I urge you all to join me in the fight for affordable housing and to address the racial inequities in Seattle public schools. And to tax the wealthy so that we can fully fund our schools. Among everybody here, I particularly want to thank Matt Remley. Matt has been the unstoppable force that drove both the Indigenous Peoples Day resolution and today's boarding school's resolution to success. And I thank him. I also wanted to share with you a story behind this necklace that I'm wearing. Last year, Matt gave this to me on my birthday because it has a symbol of warriors from his community. And I took it to mean that it was a gift from one warrior to another. I am really thankful that Ms. LaDuke is here to join us in the celebrations, and I thank her for all her work preceding our work here. Let's keep moving forward. Solidarity.
Miigwech, miigwech. Ani nindwe maginaduk, hello my relatives. Thank you very much for the honor of being out here with you. What a great day it is, huh? I'm like so happy. It's so liberating. You know, I was thinking on that, if it was a Columbus Day sale, does that mean I get to go walk around to all the stores and take whatever I want, huh? I'd rather have this. It's much better. You all are really great for having it. You know, I just have to confess, I got to go to Minneapolis's last year. You know, they had Indigenous Peoples Day, and it was just like this. It was like, how liberating, huh? Right on. I was like, oh, none of that stuff's all gone. We get to do this and celebrate how awesome it is for Indigenous peoples. So thank you for this enlightened moment by the Seattle City Council and the City of Seattle to do this, to recognize Indigenous peoples as a part of this world. Thank you to the Duwamish people, the Squamish people, and the Muckleshoot people for their territory that I have come to. I'm very grateful to be here. Thank you for the place of the Salish Sea. That's pretty cool that y'all did that. I'm really big on this naming and, you know, and this unnaming of things. Could you ever notice, like, this whole continent is, like, named after a bunch of, like, basically named after a bunch of white guys. And I was like, you know, what kind of brain like makes it so that you could name something as large as a mountain as after something as small as a human? Right. You know, it's like perplexed me my whole life. And, you know, it changes how people view things if it's named after all these guys. And so we're just beginning. But you guys are doing some leadership out here. And, you know, I really appreciate that as we look out across. There's a lot of work ahead in the renaming. And the recovery and the restoration of places, and I'm grateful that I come out here. So in doing this, and remembering our ancestors and those who sang here and prayed here in this place, those who knew the secrets of creation, the stories of relatives who have wings and fins and roots and paws as they emerged to this world and nourished us. In doing this, we honor all that is before us, and we honor all here and those yet to come. And yet we reaffirm our place here as a people who remember, as a people who do not suffer from historic amnesia. Right. Do not suffer from ecological amnesia, but are a people. We are a people who live today in a civil society which knows where it is exactly and is willing to be healthy, healthy and beautiful. So I'm really grateful to be here with you on this day. So for all of us, you know, I'm 56. And in about 54 years of those lives, I had to have that Columbus thing shoved down my throat just like the rest of you, right? And somehow it was palatable. You know, I mean, they made it like it was the way that it was. And I'm never going to understand that. How they, and you know, that all worked out for all those years. And so when I think of BC, I think of before Columbus. I also think of before Cook, if you are from the Pacific Islands. Yeah, that's right, yeah. And I think of it as before colonization. What I know is that you cannot live in a place for 10,000 years with such grace and elegance without being great peoples. And now is this opportunity when we begin, perhaps, to be able to tell those stories with light and beauty, with light and beauty, instead of kind of marginalized into some part of your anthropology class. You know, I'm really tired of being over there in the anthropology class, I have to say. So maybe, you know, in no longer having historic amnesia, we remember that for 10,000 years we lived and fished here. We made love to our husbands and our wives, and we created the finest of basket weaves in our hands. Elegant, elegant peoples. And we are those peoples today. So as I reflect on things, I think of the things that were learned and the things that were not learned. You know, we contributed 8,000 varieties of corn. That's a pretty good gig, right? I mean, get real. Like, corn does not exist in nature. It's teosinte. And the reason that corn exists is because of our ancestors and ancestors to the south of us who loved that corn and loved those plants and sang and had ceremonies and were able to create through their intelligence and their love and companionship with that plant 8,000 varieties. We had about 900 varieties of potatoes. We were not just like, you know, chilling over here. We're busy. We're busy making some great food. And then I think about these words. Someone who's a Nahuatl speaker can probably help me out with this, but from what I know, the word tomatl, potatl, chocolatl, and avocado are all Nahuatl words, right? Meaning that they're Western Hemisphere in origin. Now that's some pretty good stuff to introduce to the world. I don't know, a world without chocolate would be kind of rough. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I love the Italians, but they would have no marinara sauce. We would not have, you know, like 90% of their cool cuisine if it was not for us, right? And so you look it up, and I was looking up on like Wikipedia or something, and they say here, what it says is, the Spanish brought the tomato to Europe. I was like, there's like an omission about where they came from. Was this like from like outer space that the Spanish came with the tomato? You know what I'm saying? The Spanish brought the tomato to Europe in 1540. I was like, well, where did they get that tomato? You know? The medicine of acema, we call it acema. It is tobacco. It is a medicine and it is a curse if you misuse it, like most of our medicines. It is a great gift on how you talk directly to the Creator in our territory. It is also something you should not misuse. We have pharmacology to heal, the magic of our medicines, which is how we have survived for all these years, whether it was ephedrine, or whether it is aspirin or quinine, the multitude of medicines that come from Indigenous people that we never got any credit for. And today, as biopiracy continues in the Amazon, what you see is major multinational drug companies down there prospecting and trying to take traditional knowledge and traditional medicines that are for people and turn it for private profits. But we have that knowledge of those medicines. And then we have knowledge of climate. I was looking at these pictures of something called a winter count, which, you know, a lot of people know, but a long time ago we used to, in the northern plains, people used to write their history by drawing on the side of buffalo robes. That's how we kept a lot of our history, and they had marked significant historic events. And so there was a winter in Mandan territory where the snow was higher than the teepees. That is some climate knowledge that our peoples have historically. That is something that needs to be referred to a little bit more in this era. We are the people who, of course, contributed representational democracy to the United States. Now, y'all know that, but a lot of people do not know that in public office, right? You know, the fact is that the people who came to this country, they had no experience whatsoever with democracy. They came from monarchy and feudalism. They came from being imprisoned and treated like third-class citizens. And so they came here, and where did they go to learn about democracy? They had sources from different places, but they went to see the Iroquois Confederacy, who had developed a representational democracy and a confederacy, right? And what they knew, after many years of battling each other, the Iroquois Confederacy knew enough to put their weapons down at the foot of a tree and make peace. That is a lesson that has never been learned by the United States, has it? And when those guys came to see our people, they took notes on representatives and such, but they had a pretty significant omission, which I think most of us in the room know, which is that the Klan mothers are who appointed and removed the chiefs. And in this country, of course, when they created their representational democracy, the only people could vote were white men who owned property. And some of that property was also people. So we got some work to do on this democracy thing, because I haven't seen it fully evolve yet, if anybody knows who's in Congress and who's in the Senate. But in Seattle, I see a lot of people of color, and I see more and more people that look like all of us in office. And that is what we need across this country. There are lessons that still need to be secured. And so when I see something like Indigenous Peoples Day, I see kind of like the opportunity, you know, as Bob Marley would say, Bob, to liberate your mind, right? To let stuff go and to recognize that some people had a much better idea than you did in your entrenched power system. And now would be some time to take some good notes, because things are not working out perfectly for us all, right? So it's this opportunity. I think about what some of those opportunities are. For instance, if you look on a worldwide scale, there's about 9 million prisoners in the world, and we got 2.2 million or 2.3 million of them here in the United States, right? Highest rates of incarceration, and all of us have relatives in prison, right? That's me. I have family who has been in prison, and I have family that is now in prison, because I come from people that look like this. And that is how you usually end up in prison in this country, as if you are poor or brown, right? Now, if we had learned something in America a little bit better from Indigenous people, we would know something about restorative justice. And the idea that, for instance, in the case of Crow Dog versus Spotted Tail, where Crow Dog assassinated Spotted Tail, in 1883 or 1882 in South Dakota, the Lakota justice system said that the descendants of Crow Dog had to now care for the family of Spotted Tail, because they had denied them the man, the head of their family, who would care for their food. And so that family was now responsible, the other family, the Crow Dog family. The United States did not like how that worked out, and instead created the Major Crimes Act and said that Indian people should be in a punitive justice system, because that has worked out so well for the United States, right? And in that, they did sentence him to death, because that is how a punitive justice system works, right? But with the passage of the Major Crimes Act came upon our territory. But I do not believe he was actually killed, because the court ruled that he was in a double justice system. But I'm still saying that in our next evolution, if we continue the process of understanding what Indigenous people bring, maybe we can create a multicultural civil society where some of these teachings exist as a part of public policy. We can learn a lot from Indigenous people's economics, because from what I see, the economics of conquest, colonization, and capitalism is not working out well either for the majority of us or for the earth. You cannot keep exploiting. You cannot keep exploiting, taking more than you need and not leaving the rest. Nor can we continue to live in a society which decides that it could externalize all its problems, dumping them in third world countries, yeah, or dumping them in our territories. What we know is that in Indigenous economics, your wealth was attributed to how much you gave away, not how much you accumulated. Your status and your recognition in your society is not based on your hoarding, like the Koch brothers. Your status is what you do for your family, what you do for your community, and how much you give away of yourself and of your wealth. And I think that there is a great amount to be learned from that kind of a knowledge and that kind of economic system. That's also how you can hang out for a lot longer if you are careful and respectful. In our public policy wisdom, we could learn a lot from Indigenous peoples' teachings of considering in each deliberation the impact upon the seventh generation from now. Right now, public policy is written by politicians for election years, and the hand on the pen is usually an oil company, or a pharmaceutical company, or a coal company, or a utility. Those who have money influence our public policy. Because what has happened in our society, as you all know, is that the energy industry and Monsanto control a lot of the politics. That is not going to work out well for us over the long haul. And if we were a reflective society, we would learn from the teachings of the Iroquois that say in each deliberation we consider the impact upon the seventh generation from now. Because what I know is that which you know, which is that everything we have today, we inherited. We are very, very fortunate that our ancestors were strong people. We're very, very fortunate that our ancestors took care of this land so well. We are very, very fortunate that our ancestors stood up and fought for every right that we have, every recognition that we have. And we also know that those who are not yet here are counting on us to not mess this up. Because they are not here, they are counting on us to make sure that there will be water for them to drink, that there will still be fish, that the air will not be so poisoned or so hot that they cannot live. And so it is important that we consider how we make public policy that is not based on today's election years, but is instead based on a long-term view of how you protect the commons. How you do that is you do something enlightened like Bolivia does. A country headed by an indigenous leader, Evo Morales, and the Ho-Chunk Nation of Wisconsin recently just passed the rights of Mother Earth as a part of their constitution. Because I believe, like many of you likely do as well, that rivers also have a right to live. And that the salmon have a right to continue to exist and not be over-allocated to fishing trawlers and have their rivers poisoned. All of life, all of our relatives have these rights. So those are some of the things that I hope to see as we continue to evolve as civic society and as civil society together, because we are all in this together. But let us just say a few things about where we are now. I want to say that the Duwamish are full people. I do not believe that the price of real estate should determine whether or not you are federally recognized. What you'll find is that that is how it has worked out. You take the Wampanoag people who live on Cape Cod, and it took them a very long time to get federal recognition. And that is because of the price of real estate. And a lot of you have Hawaiian brothers and sisters, and you know that Hawaiian people's rights are very small in comparison to even our minimal rights we have held on to as indigenous people. And my theory on that is price of real estate. The price of real estate does not determine whether or not you are a person. And we all know that these people have been here for a very long time. Greed in real estate should not determine the identity of people. I am very proud in reviewing City of Seattle's recent history. Well, I was actually just super proud of all the people who kayaked out there when Shell came to town. Right? And I want to say, you know, Indigenous people, as we're talking about that Columbus guy who came towards our shores, do not let, it's not a good idea to let the ships come in. Don't let shell move into your harbor.
Hell no.
Do not let them move into your harbor. Because oil companies are not entitled to the world. You know? I come from a place that is joined to you in many ways. You know, I live in northern Minnesota in my own territory. I live on the same lake that my great-great-great-great-greats lived on. You know? And that's a great privilege to be one of those people, you know, that is in the same place. That is a privilege of being an Indigenous person. And in this moment in time, we're facing the largest oil pipeline company in the world, the Enbridge Company. But they are just like Kinder Morgan trying to come in here. They're just like those guys trying to go to Cherry Point, right? And everybody trying to come in with their fossil fuels. And at this moment in time, it's really, really important that we say no. And we stop these guys across the board. Because if we, you know, unless we're all missed something, this is the hottest year in record, and it was 165 degrees in Iran this summer. Did y'all see that on the heat index? Hottest record in history. And they just got, what, 27 inches of rainfall in 2 days in South Carolina. That is the climate change catastrophe. That is the catastrophe that we have brought upon us from emissions 50 to 70 years ago. What we are doing now, and what they are attempting to do, what Shell is attempting to do in the Arctic, what the Koch brothers are attempting to do in the tar sands, and what they are trying to do to bring those bomb trains out here from the Bakken, is to combust the planet to oblivion. It is our spiritual moment to stop them. It is our moment as the people who are here where we can stop them from doing that. We can stop them from combusting the planet to oblivion, from poisoning the waters, and from genetically engineering the world's food supply. That is our moment. And we get to be the people who do that. So that's how I see this. And we are certainly all in this together. So there are a few lessons in closing I think about. You know, first, one more time, I'm super happy to be here with y'all. There are, you know, this, a few years ago, I was in Germany, and this, it's kind of a long story, but I'm not, it was uncomfortable. We'll go with that. And I was like, oh, what am I doing here? I was doing something because my father had passed away. I was doing something with my father. I was like, oh, I'm here. Anyway, so I was like, this German journalist came to talk to me, and I'm trying to be cool. I was like super tired and super not patient, but I was trying to be cool. And the guy says, he starts talking to me about imago cells. Have any of you ever heard of imago cells? All right, the reason I'm telling you this is because you can learn something from anybody. That's the part of the point of this, is like be a little more humble, right? And like sometimes the person that you are just about to go, oh, I don't want to talk to that person, they give you this great gift of this thing. So imago cells are what is in a caterpillar. When they go into the chrysalis to metamorphosize, y'all know what I'm talking about? Into a butterfly, right? There's these cells that appear, they're called imago cells. And first they are killed off by the organism, by the caterpillar. And then they emerge and there are more and more of them. And they are what enables a caterpillar to turn into something as beautiful as a monarch butterfly. It's the imago cells. It is the same word, it has the same root as the word imagination. And I think about that because sometimes it takes those cells or those people to come out and, you know, maybe we're getting pounded down. You know, I've been with a lot of you in the streets and I've been on a lot of streets demonstrating. I've been arrested. You know, I've been hit on the head anytime recently and I'm trying to avoid that one because I'm a little too old. But you know what I'm saying? Is that sometimes you do it and you do it and you do it and then finally they take over. And that is part of what I see this opportunity as, this opportunity of enlightenment. And so in this beautiful world that it is our opportunity to make, I think of things like my relatives to the south, or our relatives to the south, at Hoopa and Yurok, who conduct world renewal ceremonies. And I think about the beauty of somebody who renews the world through their ceremonial commitment every year. And I'm grateful to them because I think that the world is renewed each year because of those prayers and those ceremonies. And it is our opportunity to be those people and to make this world beautiful. So as the forces of the unenlightened and the evil and the greedy oil companies and the chemical companies try to poison our water and poison our air, remember that our resistance is what stops them. They get what they want unless you stand up. Unless you go to your city council, unless you go to the hearings, unless you fight them. And I'll tell you something that y'all probably know by now, which is that the longer you fight them, the more expensive their project is. And at a certain point, they might go bankrupt. I think that's what happened to Whoops. Isn't that what they're called? Washington Public Power and Supply. Right? With their nuclear power plants. What a bad acronym. Who chose that for them, huh? Whoops. Whoops. And because a lot of people stood on the line and said, we don't want another nuclear power plant here, they went bankrupt. A lot of these guys should just be bankrupt, you know? They should not benefit anymore from stealing from the earth and stealing from people. They're bad ideas. But you gotta fight them. And then you have to work to make the difference. And how you rebuild and restore a beautiful world is through your actions. It's through your ceremonies, our ceremonies, through our prayers, through our feastings, right? And it is through our actions. I think of that guy, Masaru Emoto. I know some of you know who I'm talking about, the water crystal guy, right? Doctor. Dr. Emoto, right? Right, and remember what he does? If you take polluted water and you sing and you pray to it and you celebrate it, the water becomes beautiful again, right? And that is a teaching of the beauty of the human being spiritually and our place in the universe. So do not forget that we have that great spiritual power, because we have that as humans. We just need to make sure that we actualize it, right? And then we also have the ability to clean things up. I was out east hanging out with some of my cool people this last week. This guy named John Todd was talking about water purification systems. And I was like, he says, I'm a water doctor. And I was thinking about that. You know, the main thing is don't make a worse mess, right? But then start getting busy cleaning it up, what we got, right? We have the ability to do that. Last year, I rode horse in Washington, D.C. with the Cowboys and Indians opposing the Keystone XL pipeline. Super, super awesome. I went out there and I was with my two sons, they're 15, and then my sister, she's like 6'2", we call her the Genghis Khan of the Ojibwe women. She's like, I go to meetings with her and I'm like, if you didn't like talking to me, you could talk to my sister. They usually would rather talk to me. She's like terrifying, you know? So we're out there riding, and I don't know if any of you, some of you ride horse? Yeah. Okay, so a place you don't want to ride horse, let me just say this is downtown Washington, D.C. Right, you know what I'm saying? It's like riding horse, and I'm like, there's like sirens, there's cop cars, there's flashing lights, there's banners, and there's people who want to take a picture of the guy next to you on a horse, walking in front of you, and you're going, that's a really bad idea, honey. Right? You know, anyway, so this is me, and I'm like totally terrified on the horse, and then I'm like, wait, I'm supposed to be praying, don't be scared, you know, so this is me. So I get off my horse, and I go to my teepee, which is on the Washington Mall. And I just like saying that. Doesn't that sound cool? I'm in my teepee on the Washington Mall. There's like 8 Lakota teepees and the Honor the Earth Ojibwe teepee. We're chilling. You know, we're all on the Washington Mall and our teepees in the Washington Mall. Okay, I said that enough times. Y'all got that, right? So I'm hanging out in my teepee in the Washington Mall, and then Neil Young comes and hangs out in my teepee in the Washington Mall, right? Dear Hannah's hanging out in my teepee in the Washington Mall, right? And then it's just me and my sons, and this guy comes and sticks his head in the door of the teepee, and he's like, Ms. LaDuke, would you like to go for a ride in my car? And I'm looking at the guy, I'm thinking, like, that is such an 80s pickup line. So it's like, you know, and my two 15-year-old sons are there, and they're going like, no, Mom, you are so not going for a ride in this guy's car. And I'm like looking at the guy thinking, why won't I go for a ride in car? So the guy says, it's a Tesla. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I want to go for a ride in your car. Right? So the point is, y'all know, no combustion engine, right? So I walk out of my teepee into a red four-door Tesla. Right? I get in this Tesla, no combustion engine. The guy powered it on solar panels at his house. Right. Sweet. This is sounding pretty good now, right? You know? But that's basically what I want. I want to walk out of my teepee into a Tesla. Right? So I want you to think about that. Now, of course, I don't think anybody in this room could actually afford a Tesla at this point, right? But the point is that I want to move in an And I want to move in an elegant way to a post-fossil fuels economy. I want to live in an economy where the food is local, I know where it came from, and the farmer was respected. Right? And that there is nothing called side on it. Pesticide, herbicide, fungicide, because if it says side, it means death. That's where homicide, genocide, and suicide come from. So enlightened societies would not put things that say side on things they eat, right? That's just my thinking on this, but you know, you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think I'm wrong, right? I want to live in a place where the energy that I use in my society is efficiently consumed. We waste 57% of our power in this city between point of origin and point of consumption. And that's not the way an enlightened society lives. You don't have exploding gas mains, right? And you don't waste everything, and you don't destroy vast river systems and destroy other people to keep the lights on. You live in an efficient and enlightened society, which can exist, but you need the political will to do the right thing. I want to live in a society where the quality of life is not determined by the level of income. That we all have some decent way of living and that we are not in duress. My community is under duress, as are most of your families and are most of your communities. I do not want to live in duress if I can pay my heat bill. I don't want to live in duress on how much bail money I have to come up with. And I do not want to live in duress to worry about how things are going to work out 3 months from now because I'm hand to mouth. You know, that is what we are after. And that is what we owe to those generations that are not yet here. And that is something that is in the power once we liberate our minds for us to do. In my language, this month is called Banakwe Ogeezus. It means when the leaves fall. The month that follows it is Gashkadno Gizus, freezing over moon, sometime around November. Manitou Gizus Soons, little spirit moon. Gishi Manitou Gizus, the great spirit moon. Namaybina Gizus, that's a sucker moon, that's a kind of a fish. Then we have Onaabana Gizus, hard crusted snow moon. That's around March, also known as the moon you don't want to do a face plant in the snow. Iskigami Ziki Gizus, our maple syruping moon. Wabagana Gizus, flower moon. Odeimina Gizus, strawberry. Mean Gizus, blueberry. Manominake Gizus, our wild rice making moon, our most sacred food. That's what the moons sound like in my language. There are moons that are the same from out here, different people speaking a different language, but the same story. I thought you might like to hear my language, but I also wonder if y'all noticed that none of those moons is named after a Roman emperor. I'll get that. It's okay. It's okay. No counseling is needed. It is possible to live in a society with a worldview that does not include empire. opportunity I believe we have, and as we open our minds here, you know, I'm really honored to be here with you. I'm really honored to be here with you in Seattle. Really honored to be here in a place that is beginning the process of kind of deconstructing some of the bad naming. I don't know what you can do about that Washington State thing, though. That's going to be a problem for a while. Mountains and rivers, oceans, that's a good start, though. We're starting on it. And just great admiration and respect to y'all out here. And I want to make sure also to acknowledge that, you know, I'm happy to share our tomatoes forever with the Italians. Miigwech, thank you very much for your time.
Wow, I'm so happy to be here. I want to acknowledge that we are on the traditional territories of the Coast Salish people. And I just want to say how great it is to be back in Blockadia, back in the city that made Shell Oil blink. Back in the first major city to join the fossil fuel divestment movement. I don't know if you've heard, but you know, since Seattle made that pledge and the idea has spread, there is now $4.6 trillion that is pledged to join the divestment movement, pledged to divest with a notable exception. One of your Seattle natives, you gotta work on that. You can see this, I'm wearing a Gates Divest pin. I was quite infuriated to read an article, an interview with Bill Gates in The Atlantic that just came out, in which he described divestment as a false solution. Unlike, say, nuclear power that Bill Gates is heavily invested in, and unlike GMO seeds, and so on. He knows all about false solutions. So, you know, I know Seattle knows how to win big. So, you know, this part of the world, the Coast Salish territories, I don't know what it is, but this part of the world has clocked some of the most significant victories, if not the most significant victories, against the fossil fuel sector in recent memory. Tar sands pipelines, LNG export terminals, coal export terminals, and you know, this principle that animates our movement, which is, if you're in a hole, stop digging, has evolved into something else, which is, you know, there is no point digging this stuff up if you can't ship it out. And what you guys are doing is so critical. Because, you know, there's a big new push on to lift the oil export ban in this country, which means, you know, a big bullseye on the Pacific Northwest. There's going to be all kinds of new pushes for fossil fuel infrastructure. And we need to lock down the principle, no new fossil fuel infrastructure. We want to build the next economy now. And that economy, as you've already heard, needs to be more than green. That economy needs to be fair. That economy needs to be just. So this is not just about cleaning our economy. This is about healing our society on so many different levels. It needs to deliver justice to the people whose communities, as you just heard from Elizabeth, whose communities and whose bodies have borne the brunt of the danger, the risk, the toxicity, and exploitation of the current extractive economy. It has to be a process of healing those wounds, wounds that date back to the founding of this nation. So we're talking about Indigenous communities, justice for Indigenous communities. It's not just about supporting those communities when they stand up to the fossil fuel companies, though it's about that too. It's also about supporting the yes, the real alternatives that say that, you know, fossil fuel companies are not the only ones who can create jobs and local opportunities. And we need to fight for that just as hard as we fight against Shell. It means the people who are getting the worst deal in the current system, with its highest asthma rates, communities of color, immigrant communities, need to be first in line to benefit from this justice-based transition. That needs to be a core principle. Front lines first. Now, climate justice, you've heard this phrase a lot. It is not just a slogan. It is a set of principles and increasingly articulated policies that a vast and growing global movement is fighting for around the world. And as we get closer to Paris, and as we get closer to more and more of these false solutions that are going to be delivered from on high, from governments and corporations inside that summit, we need to be very clear on what the people's solutions are. And this is exactly the time to say we aren't willing to just call for climate action. We are calling for climate justice, and we need to be specific about what that means. So a core principle of no new infrastructure means no more sacrifice zones. We know that it is possible to power our lives, our societies, without poisoning or sacrificing anyone. And that includes the workers who are currently employed in high carbon sectors. As we transition, we bring those workers with us. We fight for the training that they need to get the jobs in the next economy. So speaking of jobs, we know from all the best research that if you invest in renewable energy, energy efficiency, public transit, you create 6 to 10 times as many jobs as if you invest that money in fossil fuels. This is a major job creator, but climate justice means that we aren't going to be satisfied with the kinds of jobs this unjust economic system will produce on its own. The transition that we're talking about is inevitable, but what we have to do is we have to fight to make that transition a justice-based transition. And, you know, when we think about climate jobs, it is not just about the jobs getting off fossil fuels, it's also the jobs dealing with the impacts of climate change that are already locked in, that we are already facing. And we see this very vividly in this part of the world with firefighting, right? Washington State had historic forest fires, wildfires this past summer, the worst ever. Your governor has just called for federal funds for disaster relief to help pay for it. You saw that this is incredibly dangerous work. You lost 3 firefighters this summer. These are climate casualties and need to be recognized as such. So this is very dangerous work. But one of the things I was shocked to learn is that Washington State is employing juvenile inmates to do this dirty and dangerous work. And this is quite shocking. Imagine sending 16, 17-year-old kids, and this is out of some twisted idea of scaring them straight. Now, California, they are coming to the end of their wildfire season, but because the drought in California has lasted for 4 years, the fires aren't ending. They're still in it. They're still fighting fires. Do you know that 4,000 of the 10,000 state California firefighters are prison inmates? Are prison inmates earning, some of them, less than $2 a day? When they are actively fighting fires, they get $2 an hour. By some estimates, this has saved the state of California $1 billion a year. And this is all about cost cutting. And this is why I have made the argument, and we need to make the argument again and again, that the logic of austerity and cost cutting is incompatible with life on Earth. In a time of unprecedented structured crisis. There is money and we need to go after it. So California, I'm coming to Exxon. So California, you know, I mean, in addition to this, you want to know what climate injustice looks like. California has unconstitutionally overcrowded prisons. So overcrowded that they have been ordered to release a great many prison inmates early. And the state of California has argued in court that they cannot do that because it would jeopardize their firefighting program. Now, understand this. Climate change is not just about things getting hotter, it's about things getting meaner. Climate change is an accelerant. If you have a highly unequal society, if you have a society in which systemic racism is the norm, climate change will make it so much worse. And we all got a vivid reminder of that on the 10-year anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, when we saw those images of what climate change looks like in a society as unequal as this country. And we cannot allow that to happen. And what we have seen again and again is that our current system, and this is why we say we need system change, not climate change. Our current system is built to globalize Katrina, to bring that system of inequality. And it was not just about the fact that FEMA abandoned New Orleans, that New Orleans African-American residents were abandoned on their rooftops. It's also about what happened next. It's also about the disaster capitalists who went into New Orleans and privatized the school system and bulldozed public housing and closed down public hospitals. This is why we need to build a cross-sectoral movement, because we fighting climate change and protecting and reimagining and rebuilding the public sphere and defending the commons is the same fight. So, yeah, we need to fight for more climate jobs, but we need to make sure they're union jobs, that they're jobs that pay a living wage. We need to fight for green, worker-run cooperatives. And you know what? Here in Seattle, you guys put the fight for 15 on the map. It went national. It went international. If any city is going to lock down these principles, it's this one. So yes, 100% renewables, as that banner says, but that's not enough. We want to get to 100% renewables in the next 2 to 3 decades. We want a 100% clean economy by mid-century, but we want to do it through energy democracy. We don't want Shell and Exxon to be the ones putting up the solar panels and wind turbines and finding ways to gouge consumers. We want this transition to be a tool, a powerful, powerful tool to build a more just economy so local communities own and control their renewable energy and the front lines do it first. I was really glad to see a lot of no TPP signs, because one of the things I have found in my research is that these trade deals that allow multinational corporations to sue governments or governments to sue on behalf of multinational corporations are a major barrier to these types of climate policies. Where I live in Ontario, we have been successfully challenged at the World Trade Organization for introducing a bold energy program that required that a lot of the wind turbines and solar panels be produced locally, 40 to 60%. We created 30,000 jobs. Many laid off auto workers got jobs in factories making solar panels. It was the definition of a just transition, and we were successfully challenged at the WTO. We cannot allow the TPP to become law. We have to fight it, and it's another. But at the same time, as we fight these unjust trade deals, we need to fight for global justice. Rather than further fortressing our borders, we need to recognize that a major driver of migration, a major driver of the refugee crisis, is both illegal wars fought over fossil fuels and climate change. Yeah. means, that means that we open our borders to far more refugees. It means that all workers have the same legal rights in this country. Climate justice means, yeah, we need a price on carbon, but it matters how we do it. It matters a lot. You know, there's all this talk of, you know, we're gonna have a carbon tax and then we're gonna give the money back. Why would we do that? We need the money to pay for this justice-based transition. We need a polluter pays climate response. And somebody shouted out Exxon. You know, the revelations that have come out about Exxon in the past 3 weeks. You know, you think nothing can shock you. And then you find out that in the 1970s, Exxon was conducting cutting-edge research before, you know, a decade before our governments first started meeting about climate change. They had their own very, very advanced field research, modeling research going on that was telling them this is happening. They were figuring out how it was going to help them drill in the Arctic. They have broken the planet, and they did it knowingly, and they lied, and they lied, and they lied, and we have a right to their profits. Do you understand this? I'm not talking about a gentle tax here. I'm saying these are odious profits, and we don't just want to divest from them. We want those profits to pay for a just transition, and we have a right to them. I hear this from people in the environmental movement. You know, climate change is already so big, we can't make it about all these other things. It can't be about poverty and racism and feminism and, oh, you're slowing us down. They are so wrong. They have been losing, and that logic has produced the failures of the past three decades. Because the only way you win against forces which with as much to lose as the fossil fuel companies is by building a vast and diverse and fighting movement that has a huge amount to gain. Thank you for everything you're doing.